So right now we are moving to first theoretical part of this day, and here is the topic USB hardware design with STM32. What we are able to see very often that the customers are using the design from our board. I see it very logical step. Before I entered ST as a student, I make exactly the same. My intention was, okay, they are manufacturing it, they should know how to design it, it should be correct. Unfortunately, this is not the truth, and we are trying to make everything possible to force the designer to make it correct. Unfortunately, ST is composed of the many groups, and so for example the MCD group microcontroller is not directly connected to the group which is taking care about the ESD protection, and put together meaning of these two groups and then forced to another group which is designing the boards, it's a nightmare. So we have at least collected the information for this group and put it into this material. So we have here the guidance how to make it so that everything is correct. But as you can see, it's working also with the not exactly correct design. So starting by example with the typical connection, this is the connection from the nuclear boards you have also available at your desk. So for the OTG, there are the D minus D plus, so the data line of the USB. Then there is the VBUS pin. On the VBUS there is the typical 5 volt provided by the host application. A device can be powered from this line, or it can be self-powered, depending on the application purpose. And also from the VBUS line, you can check the connection, disconnection using the PA9, PB13. I touched a little bit yesterday. I will talk about it a bit more later. Then, on some devices, that will be covered by friends a bit later. You need also to have the external 1.5 kilo pull-up. The pull-up resistor is there. Okay, thank you. Is there for the detection of the USB device. In the newer IPs, newer devices, this pull-up resistor is already internal, but for the older devices, you need to have it externally and handle the connection in your application. So for our board F4, this pull-up resistor is already internal, so we don't need to take care about it. It's turn it off, turn it on inside of the application. You are able to find for the bit which is controlling the pull-up resistor inside of the reference manual. Then, very important thing is the ESD protection. From the specification, ESD is not anyhow touched, so it's not exactly mandatory to use, but it's very strongly recommended to have the ESD protection for the real-world usage to protect your device. But here comes the problems. On some older ST boards, so for example the Discovery boards for F4, F407, 429, the ESD protection use was not correct and have the internal pull-up resistor. I have it on one slide later, so I no, it's a bit, or I can jump there as I'm speaking about it. Okay, so this is the old design. So this part have the internal resistor on the line. So here between the D plus out and D plus in, there is 33 ohm resistor. So this 22 ohm resistor are used here only as a workaround to have correct USB signal, as we are using not correct part. So in the parallel combination we have 13 ohms, and it's able to communicate. But if you choose longer cable, For example, up to 5 meters, which is out the USB, there is possibility that you will have the problems because the electrical signal are affected by this resistance on the bus. USB IP inside STM32 already match the characteristic impedance, so there shall be no serial resistance on the bus. So we are able then to see that some customers are using the design with 22 ohms because they see it here, but then with some different ESD protection, so there is no meaning why to use the 22 ohms. But that's also our fault that we don't have it so clearly in the documentation, and we made it like that. I'm sorry for that, but nothing more I can do right now. So back to the our original one. This is the ESD protection used on the nuclear board. This one is correct from the signal point of view. It's not harming the signal. It will work correctly also with the 5 meters. During the electrical testing, I will show you some measurement that you will be able to see it on the oscilloscope pictures. But what I then get from the ESD group, it's not exactly correct for the complete protection of the lines. So this is the theory I'm not able to understand at all. So some, I don't know, time constants, how quickly it's able to discharge the charge from the line and so on. So I just took their guidance and their recommendation for the correct parts. So different part shall be used. I have mentioned it a bit more later with complete schematic of according our recommendation. What have it? The last pin we have here. It's the ID pin used for the OTG functionality. So using this pin, it's decided if you are acting as a host or device if you intend to switch. So for one purpose only application, you don't need to handle this pin, you don't need to connect it to the microcontroller, only connect to the ground, it's showed later. So this is for the device, and if you intend to act as a host, you should also provide the voltage on the bus. So here is the LDO for controlling the voltage of the bus, and as a host you need to turn it on to provide the power on the bus. So here is no problem, GPIO with pull down to have it disabled by default. So we already passed this slide. So now for the recommendation for the ESD group. There is multiple parts that are recommended according to the usage. So for the basic usage, device only, powered from the bus. So you don't need to check if the PA9 for the VBUS connection, because you know every time you powered, you are connected to the USB. So you don't need to check the VBUS. So just simply use the USB LC6/2 and connect the D plus, D minus, ground, VBUS, and that's all. The part fit the need of the USB. It's also capable to have or to handle the high speed communication. Now we are more or less talking about the full speed, because for the high speed it's already possible to use the guidance from ST board's data sheet. This one is correct. With the full speed is the problem. But for the high speed, it's mandatory to have the EMI filter inside from the ESD point of view again. So it's better to use this part, because with the USB LC6, we would put this filter additionally, so it would be one additional part, and the cost would be higher. So this is a more optimal way for the high speed. So here is the typical application. So host device without the ID, so no OTG, and device bus powered only. But for the self-powered device, it get a little bit complicated. Because as a device, you have the pull-up resistor on D-pass, and you also need to detect if the device is connected or only suspended. So you need to put the bigger version of the USB LC6 with the more diodes inside and connect in different way, so the VBUS is not connected here, so it's not protected on the upper side or through the diode, but you still are able to detect the voltage on the D-plus and ID pin. Otherwise, it would go through the diode to the pull-up resistor, so you would not be able to detect. With the pull-up resistor, VBUS sensing and so on, there is also one hands-on in the slides we have passed. So it's for the HID device low power. And there is shown for what purpose is the VBUS sensing used. So maybe I could take a chance and explain the VBUS again. So the purpose is, if you are a self-powered device, so the power is provided from some other source, or optionally you are charging the battery then from the USB, you need to somehow change your behavior according to the state of the USB. So if the USB host go to the suspend, so for example, if you put your laptop to the sleep, the device is still connected, so the mouse is still connected. It's also capable to wake you up. But from the specification point of view, the amount of current you are able to drain for the host, it's limited. Depend on the configuration, it's limited to 2.5 milliamps or 10 milliamps. And this can be quite restrictive. So you also need to go to some low power mode or some disable some functionality, because it could be possible that if you extend the consumption, host disconnect you. This is not true in the practice, but it may happen if you violate this condition. So for this purpose, you should check if you are in the suspend, so there is no activity on the data lines, no start of frame, just the suspend, or if you are completely disconnected. So again, no activity, but also no VBUS. And again, as I told yesterday, on our peripheral, on the OTG peripheral, there is a dedicated pin on for this functionality, so it's PA9 for the OTG full speed, or PB13 for the OTG high speed. And now I can show you also in the documentation how to find the actual restriction for this pin. As we can see in the datasheet here is the mention that PB13 and PA9 are assigned to the VBUS sensing. So here we have it. But with the usage of this feature is connected also some power consumption. So you need to provide typically 200 microamps to this pin, so it's functional. If you put the correct voltage on this pin for during the VBUS sensing activity, or when the VBUS sensing is active, and you don't allow there enough current, So for example, by some voltage divider setting, if you use very high values, there is not enough current to the peripheral, and it's not detected, even there is enough voltage. So you need to make it accordingly. And second thing is why actually we need to handle this is the absolute maximum rating. So for the input voltage on a 5-volt tolerant pin, we have maximally VDD plus 4. If you are battery powered, the battery is completely empty, so there is zero on the VDD. And you connect the VBUS, so the 5-volt, directly to the PA9, you are violating this condition. So this should be prevented, but it's on all our boards and never see any problem. But to be 100% in line with the specification, this shall be handled. Then is also the possibility that instead of the PA9 and PB13, you use any other GPIO for the interrupt and so on. So again, you shall fulfill the condition of the absolute maximum rating, so the VDD plus 4, but you don't need to care about any current, because typical GPIO is voltage sensitive, so it sends only the level of the voltage, so it's enough if you use any type of the voltage divider that fulfill the condition that you are below 4 volts, but still in the range that VDD times 0.7, and it will be detected. Only it's not automatically handled by the peripheral, so you need to take care about it inside of your firmware. So detect the interrupt from this pin and turn on the peripheral, and the same if you detect the disconnection. So PA9, PB13, do it automatically. With any GPIO, you need to handle it manually. About this topic, we have also some remarks on the community in the FAQ, and all of this is described here. So how to handle the VBUS. So back to the ESD protection. This is what we have recommended for the USB high speed. Actually, this is used in our schematics for the various boards. So for example, F4 eval boards, F7 discovery eval boards. The design schematic for the USB high speed is correct in our documentation, and you can follow this recommendation. It's fine. So here it's again the VBUS sensing, VDD plus 4, consumption and usage of the any GPIO. So here I have the schematics. You have it also in your materials about the recommendation we have with all the consideration for all the use cases. So USB bus powered device. So you have here the USB LC6, which is protecting the data lines. No other serial resistor on the lines. For the ID pin, which is on the USB connector, just connect through 100 kilo ohms to the ground, and some voltage regulator to power the MCU. Quite simple, not many parts needed. So then, if you are acting as a self-powered device, so here in this scenario, there is no battery, so it's quite similar to the use case we have with the nuclear board. So we have independent power for the board, and then the USB application don't source anyhow the microcontroller on or don't source the battery. So in this scenario, we need to use the bigger version of the USB LC6. Again, the ID pin is connected only to the ground, but still connected to the ESD protection. And then, according to the specification, we should take care about the VBUS sensing. But if you intend not to use suspend or don't care in the difference between suspend and disconnection, you can somehow align according to that. In the next use case is also added to the proposal for some battery charging, but it's only in the block with the battery, so it's then up to you. So here it's the proposal that you have the battery, and either you are powered from the battery or from the VBUS, and you should be also able to charge the battery. So quite standard way, but you need to somehow handle the battery. For the host, it's almost the same, so just simple ESD protection, and you need to handle the VBUS and source the bus in this case. And if you intend to use the on-the-go functionality, you mix the previous examples and that's it. But as we already mentioned, there is no support for this functionality inside our library, so the peripheral is supporting it, not our library. If you need this functionality and don't want to write by your own, there are some software partners providing already such solutions, but it's not free of charge. But if you want, we are able to provide you a list of our partners where you can find who could help you with this. Now, this is the next problem that customers time to time find some high-speed PHY. So as was mentioned yesterday, our USB high-speed peripheral, or in the most cases, there is only one exception. So in most cases, we need to have external high-speed PHY. Only exception is F723, where the high-speed PHY is already embedded inside. So this is the only exception. Otherwise, for F2, F4, other F7, H7 chip, you need to have the external USB PHY, which is connected through the ULPI interface. And we have some tested parts which are used on our board. Some other parts are tested during some developments, for example, during support of some customers and so on. So we have a list of recommended PHYs. Then we have two PHYs which were tested, and at the end we were not able to run with them due to some timing constraints or some other problems. So please, if you intend to use the USB high speed and don't want to use F723 with the embedded high speed PHY, take this list into your consideration. It can ease your job significantly. As already mentioned, the schematic for the high speed is correct inside the ST schematics of the discovery boards, evaluation board, so feel free to use this one without any constraints. So the summary of the hardware design for USB board: do not use the serial resistor on data lines. Later on during the electrical testing, I will show you what this can done in your application. Then get some ESD protection. From our side, it's recommendation of the ST part for sure. There is a lot of other vendors. If you are confident about their solution, feel free to use it, but we have ST recommendations. And be aware about the VBUS sensing, it can be tricky. Last mention here is again the repetition that if you use the OTG high speed peripheral, you can use as full speed with the embedded PHY, with the advantage of the DMA usage. So this is also possible. If you have some F4, F7, which have both, so the OTG full speed and OTG high speed, they are independent, each of them have the independent FIFO, so you can use both of them in one time. For the power supply, inside of the datasheet, you may find that the USB peripheral demands to have at least 3 volt supply voltage. So on some L0s, F0s and some other microcontrollers L4, you may found also the VDD USB. So the peripheral and the pins connected to the peripheral have the independent voltage. So for example, you may run your microcontroller on 2 volts, but if you want to use the USB, you need to have the 3 volts for the VDD USB. Then, if you use this, for example, L0, and you don't want to use the USB, and you don't need to use the PA11-12 and PA9, so the pins connected to the OTG, you don't need to power the VDD USB at all, but it needs to be at least grounded, connected to some potential. If you want to then use, for example, the P9 as a standard GPIO, don't want to use the USB on the L0, you can connect it also to 2 volts. So the maximum voltage on the PA9 in this example will be also 2 volts. So GPIO is working in standard way, but you are not able to use the USB peripheral. Then on the H7, which is for now our most high-performance microcontroller, there are 2 high-speed peripheral with some additional features, and also with the dedicated internal regulator from 5 volt to 3 volts. But here is the restriction that you are not able to use the voltage from the regulator for any outside functionality. It's only for the internal powering of the peripheral. For the clocking, the USB is very sensitive on the clock precision. So for the most of the application, you need to use the high-speed external. The exceptions are the device for the device where there is some synchronization. So for example, L4, L0, F0. On some of these devices, you can find a so-called clock recovery system. So there is internal oscillator, which is fine-tuned from some other source. For example, from a host start of frames signal. So this is with the frequency 1 millisecond. And this can fine-tune the internal oscillator in the demanded precision from the USB peripheral. So as then it's called USB crystal resolution. So you are you don't need to use the crystal in such application. Another thing is on the L476 and similar weights, there is the possibility to fine tune the internal oscillator from low speed external. But this is enough only for the device functionality. When you want to use the host functionality, high-speed external is mandatory because the clock frequency needed by the host is higher. And the last one, the high-speed PHY. Be aware about the constraints for the types. Okay, so now we pass the chapter about hardware design. So now, as I promised you, there I will show you where it's mentioned in the specification that you need to have the correct precision. Okay, so it's mentioned here. So the high-speed data rate 480 megabit per second, and accuracy of plus minus 500 ppm. And this is mandatory for host hubs, And high-speed capable functions. Functions from the specification mean the device. Here is the device is mentioned as a USB in some USB in overall, and function mean device only from I don't know normal way of usage for the regular people. They are not able to pretend what is the function. So any type of host, so full speed host, high speed host, need to have this precision. Also the same for a hub. And the high-speed device only also need to have this precision. So that make the bit constraint for us. For full-speed function only, there is 2.5 ppm, so it's not so strict, and we are able to run from different source. And also, what happens if you don't have the correct source? The usual scenario is that you are not correctly synchronized with the host, and typical for the Windows is that he asks for any type of descriptor 3 times. And as you are not correctly synchronous, you get the error during the communication, so you are not able to answer with any handshake on any of the 3 requests for the descriptor, and you are disconnected. So usually you get some message like unknown device, corrupted device, or something like that. We will be able to see it on the electrical testing during the end. And there is also the measurement that the frequency of the device is out of the range.